Morning. Friday. Today is December 30th and Halloween weekend ahead of us. Halloween tomorrow, actually. First off, wanted to apologize for the amount of time between episodes. It's been really busy. I'm renovating the house right now, literally painting the house, laying in floors. I got roofers coming out, taking bids on a new roof. So I just haven't had a whole lot of time for videos. Things will get back to normal, and when they do, I'll be running videos more often. Meanwhile, let's go ahead and move on to what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about two things. One is a custom short length dropout that I designed for Peak Cycle Forks. We're going to go over that. And secondly, we're going to talk about this tool. When I first got it, I just pretty much introduced it to you. I didn't really show you how it works. This is made by BlueRock Tools. This is a pipe polisher or sander. And we're going to demonstrate that today. So, let's go ahead and hit the shop, see what's happening with Peak Cycles. Jump in here real quick before we actually go on to sanding that tubing, is that when I first received this tool, it comes with this handle. You can screw it in the top here on the underside, and you find that happy position. You got your tubing or your frame and the vise, whatever it is that you're sanding smooth. And my buddy Josh, who turned me on to this out there at BMF Customs, he's like, yeah, man, the best thing about that is you can bench mount it. I'm like, bench mount it? I'm like, what do you mean? Shoot me a picture. Just simply threw it in the vise. Keep it going. Are you BlueRock Tools, telling you, when these first came out, they were over $1,000. Not this brand, but the concept of the tool, over $1,000. Now you can purchase this from BlueRock Tools for $200. Best $200 you ever spent. They also provide these sanding belts, relatively cheap. I haven't even changed this one out yet, lasts you a lifetime. BlueRock Tools, game changer. Moving on to the dropouts. Now I want to make something clear. I know it sounds simple that you can just add a short dropout with rotor because we've seen it on triple trees since the beginning of time. No big deal. The problem is that with wide forks, again, with Peak Cycle forks, the dropout runs on the inside of the fork tubes. And what most guys are using is something similar to this. Everyone has their own design, but the concept is pretty much the same. The problem with these, it's not a problem, I'm just saying they're limited. And what I mean by that is, once you mount your caliper on, which goes like this, you want the cable to run upward, the direction of the fork to your handlebars, naturally. If you put this on the left side of the fork, and now you put your caliper on, your cable is running forward, which isn't going to work. So these are right side mount only. So I came up with these. I created that design right there. And these do mount left side. A lot of people like their brakes on the left side. I don't know really the reason for it. Maybe it's display when you're showing. That's the non-show side. Anyhow, came up with these left side mount. And the caliper slides underneath the dropout, like so, and now your cable is running the proper direction up the fork tube. The limitation with these is the length. they have to be this long in order for this to work. So that is where this comes in. Short dropout, left side mount, cable go in the proper direction. And to give you a better visual, I'm gonna show you some stills and I'm gonna narrate over it so you know what you're looking at. Let's go ahead and take a look.
So here we have the right side mount, which is most commonly used, and the cable facing the fork, which it should. As mentioned earlier, flip this to the left side and the cable is facing forward, which doesn't work. This is the left side mount with the caliper mounted on the underside, again with the cable facing the fork, as it should. And here we have the dropout we're working on currently. So the left side mount mocked up against a 180 rotor, showing the caliper being too close to the fork tube, so we pushed it to a 203 rotor, gave it some breathing room. I'll touch on that in a moment.
There you go. Hope that made it a little more clear for you. I know when I was first running disc brakes, I actually avoided it for a long time. I was running coaster brakes. It just seemed intimidating. I didn't know what I was doing. And I stress this all the time, especially in fabrication, that when you're welding that tab on to make certain it is dead on with those dropouts. And the reason for that is because the amount of adjustment you get out of the caliper, which is this screw and this one here, is literally just millimeters to move it back and forth. So if you're dead on with your alignment between the dropout and the tab, you know you have plenty of room for adjustment. If it's off, you can push just one way or the other and those pads are gonna rub that rotor. The other thing is the distance between the axle and the caliper. Also important, when I'm designing these, I want to make sure that I'm getting as much brake pad on that rotor as possible. Let's go ahead and get into the actual fabrication of those dropouts and keep it moving.
This is the basic shape I'm going for. I know it looks kind of funky right now, but these Sharpie lines here will be cut. This will be cut so it's in line with the bottom of the dropout, and this line here in line with the tab. The idea is to have the dropout and tab in line with each other. That keeps the caliper and rotor be able to calibrate. Normally I have dropouts cut out like this, all single piece. No problem. In this case, this is a standard dropout, so I'm trying to create something here that'll work. We're gonna weld these together only on one side because the welded side will be up against the inside of the fork tube. You won't see it. We'll keep this side open seam. Two welds down the middle. Let's go ahead and weld it together. And keep going. And how about that jig, huh? That magnet right there? Got a little small gap between the two pieces. I like to do that, as I mentioned before, so that weld falls in between and you're not just welding on top. We're gonna tack this first, mock it up against the caliper and rotor, make sure we got good clearance and plenty of brake shoe. And if we're good to go there. And so here we have it. I just basically tacked the top and bottom there. I decided not to weld it all the way through, being we're gonna weld these completely to the inside of the fork tube, so I didn't think it was necessary. The tacks are mainly just to make sure everything is in line. And we're gonna mock it up now against the brake. And if we're good to go there, keep it moving.
Pretty happy with that. In fact, I'm very happy with that. One setback is that this will only work with a 203 millimeter rotor on a 100 millimeter wide hub. And the reason for that, this is so hard to explain, especially on the phone or through messages, and I'm going to do my best right here. Here it goes. A 100 millimeter hub welded to the inside of the fork tube. And the distance here is 203. And the reason for it is just like I mentioned in the video, is that if we go smaller rotor, the tab needs to come in, which means there's no room on the fork for the caliper. The caliper hits. If you go a wider hub, like a 115, I will need to split this. I'll need to cut it, and there'll be two separate pieces, and then it's recessed on the fork. What we've done now is because we've recessed it and pushed it out, this tab now is even further away, and we don't have a larger rotor to make it work. So there's our limitations with this. I'm going to make one last attempt to create a short dropout with a rotor that could be an option of 203 or 180 left side mount. Wish me luck on that. I hope to present it in the next episode. Meanwhile, that's pretty much going to wrap it up. Hope you enjoyed today's version of what's happening with Peak Cycles. And until next time, make it a killer day!